Ladies and gentlemen, it's so good to be back with you. And unfortunately, I guess it depends on your perspective. From my perspective, it's unfortunate that this is our last time together, at least for this trip. And so maybe on your end, hallelujah, I finally made it to the end of this, and I'm still standing. So then for you, for those of you who are still standing, I'll get another shot at you in the future. Couple of things before we go to prayer. One is that I think I mentioned this on Sunday morning. If you've got grandchildren, nieces, nephews, sons and daughters that need an excellent college education and are needing a leg up to get out there and make their mark in this highly competitive world, I need a couple of students. In fact, I need some good students. So send us some students at Evangel University, and we will make things happen, and you will see changes that you are very much approving of when you see your young man or your young woman come back home. The other thing is that I need to extend my teaching time with you a little bit, but I have other jobs that I've got to go back to. So I need to see you in Israel in March, okay? And for those of you who have already been on one or another of these trips that we've done together, grab one of those people and just ask them, is it worth your shekel? Is it worth your time? And have a heart-to-heart with one of them. They're our best advertisement anyway. Did it change your perspective on life? Did it change your life? Did it change the way that you read and understand your own Bible? If the answer to that, those three questions, is not all yes, then you're off the hook and you can go watch TV, buy a bag of potato chips, and kick back. Otherwise, I'll see you in March. Let's pray. Father, thanks again for the privilege of standing before your people and breaking the bread of life and equipping the body of Christ to do the work of ministry. I pray that with the prayer and preparation and effort that I put into this, that your Holy Spirit would come alongside each one of us to teach us and lead us into all the truth on these matters that we address tonight. And we want to give you thanks, Lord, that it's never just me or Pastor Weaver, Pastor Austin, Pastor Brett, Pastor Don, Pastor Gary, just standing up and wailing away under our own strength. We want to thank you, Lord God, that we are joining hands, that we are co-laborers in the work of redemption with Jesus himself, with God Almighty. We give you thanks for that, Lord. Equip every ear to hear tonight, Lord God. Equip every heart to respond. Quicken memories, Lord, so that the things that are needed as takeaway points tonight for these priests that sit before me, when they go back to their altars of ministry, at their home, in their community, at their work, that these things will be brought back to mind and would be so fresh and would be right at their disposal to use to further your kingdom and touch people's lives for you. Lord, we pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. The uniquenesses of Christianity. What do we have? Our relationship with God, our faith. What do we have to share in the marketplace of world religions? We find ourselves in quite an interesting point of time in history, perched on the precipice of receiving even more immigrants from other cultures and other religious expressions, already swimming in a sea of multiculturalism, of pluralism and the like. This evening, I'd like to share with you some prominent aspects of our faith in Jesus that really separated off from other world religious expressions as being truly exceptional. I would argue that these elements of the Christian faith, when they're compared to the components of these other religious expressions or religious systems, render it to be the preferred choice over all of the others, and not by just a little bit. and not by just a matter of opinion. I'd like to review as many of these uniquenesses that Christianity owns, has the corner on the market, if you will, as many as time will allow, in some measure, just simply to push back against the boisterous and constant call of our culture to assimilate, to homogenize, to compromise sometimes, and to be tolerant. And by being tolerant, please recognize I'm not talking about giving people, other folks who are of other opinions, the right to believe and to exercise that belief the way that they choose, but rather the new version, the new definition of tolerance, which says everything is equal, it's all flattened out, there's no difference, all paths lead to God, and if you choose to exalt yours above all others, then you are bad, and you are wrong, and you are morally reprehensible. Most of the world today, by the way, has abandoned these words of Jesus. Next slide. Pause for effect. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except through me. I want to point out who says this. This is Jesus of Nazareth. If you have a red letter edition, these letters, these words are written in red. So when we express ourselves that Jesus is the only way to the Father, I mentioned it last night just in passing, but I'm going to drill down on it a little bit tonight. The claim comes back, well, you're simply being intolerant. You're being closed-minded. You are being unnecessarily narrow. You are being elitist. Why should you be so exclusivistic? Then our response should be, was anybody here last night? Can you give me the response? Look, I'm sorry. Don't shoot the message bearer. I didn't say this. I didn't make this up. I'm about 2,000 years too late also to take it back. Rather, it was Jesus who said this, and so if you have any issues with this point, then please feel free to take it up with him. That way you get them and Jesus eyeball to eyeball, mano y mano, right? Most of the world has rejected this in favor of the gospel according to Oprah. And if we can get the next slide, one of the biggest mistakes humans make according to the Gospel of Oprah, is to believe that there's only one way to live. Actually, there are many diverse paths leading to what you call God. There couldn't possibly be only one way. Okay? So one of these statements is right. Would you agree? Okay, we talked about John 14. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. That's what Jesus said. Oprah said there can't be only one path to God. There must be many ways to God, all of them being equal, all of them being equally acceptable. Which gospel is right? I'll let you make your choice since we're living in a tolerant, multicultural, pluralistic society. When we recite these words of Jesus or those of his closest followers, and I'd like to see the next slide, because John 14:6 is not the last word on this. You have the disciples of Jesus, his closest followers, and when they're preaching, they say this: Jesus Christ the Nazarene is the cornerstone, and there's no salvation in no one else, and there's no other name given under heaven among men by which we must be saved. No other name. So what Jesus says in the Gospel of John, and what these disciples are recorded as having said by another writer in the New Testament, Luke, are kind of one and the same. You know, we talk about all the time, let every matter be confirmed on the evidence of two or three witnesses. You've heard this, right? This is Deuteronomy 17, Deuteronomy 19. This is also Matthew 18. Paul tells Timothy that as well. It's kind of all over the place in the Bible, Old and New Testament. It's on the evidence of two or three witnesses. Did you just get two? I just got two. Jesus and John, and the apostles in the book of Acts. On the evidence of two or three witnesses, let every matter be confirmed. That's just almost a biblical way of protecting you and me from taking one Bible passage and maybe taking that a little bit out of context or a click off to the right or the left of true center and running with that and getting caught in our own rabbit trail. So keep that in mind as an interpretive method as well. If you think you've heard something from God, gotten something out of Scripture, there ought to be multiple places in Scripture that make that same point. John Wimber used to talk about focus on what is main and plain in Scripture, and you're not going to miss very much. So when we recite these words of Jesus or those words of Luke that describe the preaching of Jesus' closest disciples, we hear this message coming loud and clear out of Scripture. There is one way to salvation. One way of salvation. Jesus describes himself as, I am the door. I am the door of the sheepfold in the Gospel of John chapter 10. So it's not that we're trying to be intolerant. It's not that we're just innately bigoted. It's not that we are intentionally insensitive to the religious expressions and beliefs and concerns of other people. They're absolutely welcome to their belief system and what they want to believe. But then when we step out and we say, look, here's what I believe. I believe that Jesus is the door of the sheepfold. He's the only way to God. Then immediately when we are accused of being bigoted and intolerant, it's like, well, okay, so much for tolerance, right? Where'd all that tolerance thing go we were just talking about? Hey, how about a little bit of reciprocity here? If you want it from me, can't you at least then give it back to me? Just suggesting these are some things that you might need to trot out as points of logic around the water cooler on break or in the lunchroom or maybe at the family reunion, who knows. If you'll permit me just a little excursus before we get off into our Bible study proper tonight, I want to talk a little bit more about this matter of uniqueness. Are you aware that Christianity is not the only religious expression that believes that it's the only way to salvation? There are other religious expressions. For example, the ancient Israelites believed that they were right and all other cultures around them were idolaters and worshiped false gods, which Paul would eventually in the New Testament say, they're not even actually worshiping false gods, they're worshiping demons. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians. And then the Jews of the New Testament period, the rabbis taught all Israelites have a share in the world to come. And unless you become a righteous Gentile, then you go directly to Gehinnom, which Jesus in the New Testament, it's written out in Greek, so it's a little bit skewed. It's Gehenna. And Gehenna is another word for hell, or as we say in the South, hail. It's just spelled a little bit differently. It's the consonants are the same, the vowels are a little bit different. Like, son, that boy's going to go to hail, you know. You're aware that in the modern day, it's not just in ancient times, in the modern day, Jehovah's Witnesses believe that they are the only true faith expression. You're aware of that, right? The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, or some people refer to that as the Mormons, they believe that their expression of faith is the only way, correct? Become a little bit more contemporary and get us more in the CNN, Fox News kind of situation. Islam believes that it's the only correct faith expression. You're aware of that, right? And that's the reason behind this major global conflict that we're all experiencing right now. They have a belief that is so firm that their faith is the right faith and the only faith that should exist, that some components are intent on exterminating all other people who are of other persuasions. So much, again, for tolerance, right? But here's what's interesting. whenever you have a report by Christiane Amanpour or Wolf Blitzer or some of these other TV personalities, news people, folks that do documentaries and that kind of thing, isn't it pretty regular that it's Christianity that's the whipping boy, that's the stepchild, and not one of these other faith expressions? So I just wanted to point those things out to you as well. We are treated as though we are this major, overwhelming majority who is almost involved in an inquisition, a religious persecution of all other faith expressions, when the reality is that it's almost the exact opposite. Okay, I'm not going to bother spelling that out for you. You can do the math and figure out exactly what I'm saying on this. But that is a reality, and since it is a reality, then whenever this issue comes up again, and the words of Jesus come up, I am the way, the only way. No one comes to the Father but by me. There's no other name named under heaven whereby men must be saved. And you get pushback on that. You have some things that you've already thought through, that you've been exposed to at church. You've taken notes down. You've listened to the thing on the podcast on over and over again, riding to work, maybe on some DVD or whatever. You've got some stuff invested in you that you have material you can bring back to the table. Yes? All right. Here's another point. If you're in conversation with someone who makes the complaint back to you that you're being close-minded, too narrow, intolerant, making the way to heaven or the way to eternal life or the way to being right with God more difficult than it should be, then just I think that you should feel free to tell them that they have just been intolerant toward you. Why do they feel like they have to pass that judgment on you? You've been narrow. You've been intolerant. You've been unforgiving. You've been overly exclusivistic, etc. The same. All I'm asking you is to take and turn the mirror back around and say, "Isn't that exactly what you're accusing me of? Didn't you just do that to me?" The answer, if they're going to be honest, is yes. Oh, sorry about that. Can we restart this conversation? Here, have. Let me share my Coke, my Diet Coke with you. I would also suggest that you might, and with always in deference, always with the gentleness and the reverence that marked Jesus and that marked the early disciples that are our role models in all of this. You might remind them that Jesus believed so strongly in what he said in John 14 that he signed those words with his own blood. What he believed, he was willing to die for. I have this really weird argument that's presented to me sometimes. When I'm in dialogue with people at state schools or in coffee shops and that kind of thing, well, you know, Christianity had its martyrs, but Islam and other faith expressions, they have their martyrs too. After all, look at all those guys on 9/11 who were willing to die for what they believed in. And my response is, apples and oranges, ladies and gentlemen. Apples and oranges. Here's why. Because In order to make these things, well, let's just break them down for a second. The apostles that followed Jesus, who then wrote down his words and his life story, and then wrote other instructional stuff to the church, you have to assume that these people made this, if they were not martyrs of the true faith, then they were the originators of this version of faith. And they were the propagators of this version of faith. And then when they got arrested and put in jail and had an opportunity to recant and say, "Oh, well, you know what? I was just kidding. You know, I was just messing around with you. I'm kind of Dan Brown. Okay, I got caught with my fingers in the cookie jar. Look, we were just kind of, hey, it was a good way to kind of raise the moral fiber. We saw him as a great role model. Okay, you got me. I'm caught. But they didn't do that. Instead, they insisted on the truthfulness of these things that are recorded for us to the point that they gave their lives in the same generation that all this happened. That's the difference. The time lapse is the major difference. These guys who died in flaming planes on 9/11 did not originate that faith. They're not the ones who wrote the stuff down. They are not the immediate disciples of the prophet Muhammad. They got this from generation after generation after generation. So there is a difference. Those guys in the first century who died for what they believed in, you've got to, because it's all telescoped in the first century, you've got to assume that they perverted the record, they wrote it down, they propagated this stuff, and now they're willing to die for a lie, that something they know is not true. And that's just not normal for human beings. And when you read their writings, you recognize these guys are not flaming, wild-eyed weirdos, you know? These are not insane people. These people are very much intact, in touch with who they are, and they are very much grounded in reality. They're not wild-eyed crazies. So the idea that these are all one in this, that's again an attempt to lower the bar to the point that everybody can crawl over it, right? To try to make the martyrs of the first century like the martyrs of 9/11 is really a travesty, not just historically, but logically as well. Are you following? You follow what I'm saying? They're not apples and apples. These are indeed apples and oranges. Okay, now back to our subject. In addition to some of the better known uniquenesses of Christianity, like that we do have a Savior who died and was resurrected, okay? Not every religion can claim that. That there's real forgiveness of sin. There's not a balancing of the scales like in karma, as in Hinduism and Buddhism. It's not likely we're going to balance the scales in this life, at least if you lived a life like I did before he got me. There's not much balancing of the scales. Too many people that I did wrong, I can't go back and fix. I'm really thankful then that this forgiveness that Jesus offers me by taking my place, I mean, this is not sissy stuff. This is, okay, I'll bear that responsibility. I'll remove the clothing from off my back and let them beat me half to death. I'll do that for you. And I'll hang on that cross for you, and I will shed my blood as a blood sacrifice in your place. That ought to be you. That's going to be me. That's serious business. That's grown-up, big boy, big girl stuff. And it's real forgiveness. It's not ignoring the sin. It's not covering up the sin. It is real cleansing, washing away, forgiveness of sin. Forgiveness. Though our sins be as white as snow, as red as scarlet, I will make them white as snow. That's what you hear in Isaiah. Okay, here's another thing. Real reconciliation with God. He's not just been appeased. We haven't just put him off. We have now been made right with God. It's like two warring countries that Jesus stepped into the middle of, said, look, whatever the grievances are on both sides, I will take that on myself. Let me join your hands back together and make you right, make you connected again. Real reconciliation with God. We stand, ladies and gentlemen, if you're a son or a daughter of the great King, he looks at you right now as the great judge of all the earth, and he looks at you through the righteousness of Jesus, and you are right in right standing in his eyes. You are. That doesn't mean you have to go anywhere or do anything or learn anything or have somebody pop you on the forehead, knock you over in a meeting somewhere. It means you're right. You are in right standing with God. You can't get that in just every dime a dozen garden variety world religion. It just doesn't exist. The sanctity of human life as created in God's image. Not every religious expression has that. Not in the same way that we do. We believe that every human life is created in the very image of God and is therefore has intrinsic worth, whether that person is mentally retarded or Down syndrome, or that person is a quadriplegic, or that person is of another race, or that person is of another gender. We are all created in God's, in the very image, stamped with the very image of the God who created all of us and everything that we see. And therefore, all of life is sacred. Sacred. Not expendable. I've lived in the Middle East where retarded young ladies have C4 vests strapped to them, and they are sent to checkpoints and are then detonated by remote control. I've seen where little children who are elementary school age, 6, 7 years old, the family's promised a certain amount of money, and that child is sent with the vest strapped on to a checkpoint to blow up soldiers that work for the other side. Is that the same value of human life? Is that the same degree of sanctity of human life that we who know Jesus and have been born of His Spirit, that we have also come to accept? I don't think so. You see what I'm saying? And I am talking in extreme, but I'm looking at the A and the Z of the thing. How about the unique hope that Christianity provides, not just for this life, but for the next one as well? Or that sense of inner peace and that sense of purpose and meaning that comes, that greater sense of purpose and meaning that comes to life because we know the author of the life. Real inner peace. A sense of greater direction in our lives because we know that we are among the called of God. All things work to the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose. Well, that means that all of us are called, not just pastors, missionaries, ministers of music and what have you, that we are all called and that we are special and precious in His eyes, that all of life then comes to mean more because of who we are in relationship to and what we have in common, what we believe. The highest ethical standards known to man, and everybody admits this. Ask well-educated rabbis, they'll say, yes, the ethical code of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, is the highest standard of ethics that anyone has ever been given in the history of mankind. People in other religious expressions will admit that in the teachings of Jesus, you find the apex of moral expectation. And I just want to remind you guys, it's impossible to live that on your own, by yourself, in your own strength. I don't care how good a person you are or how long you've been a Christian. Someone slaps you on one cheek, turn to him the other also. Not normal, just not even human. It's not typical behavior for any old body. Pray for those who despise you. Bless those who despitefully use you. That's not real easy living, is it? So God is always going to be calling those of us who become His sons and daughters to ever higher and higher expectations, ones that we can't really fulfill in our own strength. And so what's the key to burnout and to frustration and to failure and that kind of thing? How do you get there from where we are? Lean on His empowerment. The same God who calls is also going to empower. We talked about this already, right? It's not through our best efforts or our, you know, ingenuity at making good New Year's resolutions. It's not by us just pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps, just willing it to be so. There's weariness in that, right? There's condemnation in that because we're never going to quite measure up. God will always call us a little bit out of our comfort zone so that we've got to trust Him, out of our natural, out of the scope of our natural abilities to cause us to trust Him. If you haven't gotten anything other than that specific point in this week's teaching and preaching and study together, I pray that that's one of your takeaway points. It's not about me trying harder, working smarter. It's about me leaning more on this infinite source of power and inspiration that we get from the God that has called us out of darkness and into light. Okay. So in addition to all of those uniquenesses, I want to focus on a few in particular. If you want to take notes, you're welcome to, or you can just look at this and rerun. Next slide, please. Christianity, here's another uniqueness of Christianity. It's an historically based faith. It's a historically based faith. Not all religious expressions can say that. Many of them are philosophically based faiths. Take, for example, Scientology. God bless Tom Cruise. I kind of feel sorry for him, even though he is better looking than I am. Okay? Christianity is a historically based faith. That's true also of the mother religion, Judaism. Sorry, that's just the way it is. We both share this. Historically based faiths. Okay, so let's look at a couple of texts. In Exodus 3, God tells Moses, "The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you." This is what God tells Moses how God tells Moses to identify the God that called him to the people of Israel who were still in Egyptian slavery. They're surrounded by literally hundreds of Egyptian gods. So, okay, great. This God's going to deliver me. He's going to take me out of slavery. Which one? Right? In a polytheistic situation, which God? By the way, that should tell you already, right off the bat, we are not in a unique situation with different people, different belief systems, different religions, different deities and that sort of thing. This has been going on for hundreds, literally thousands of years. They made it through. There was a deliverance for this generation. There's one for us too. Okay? We're not entirely unique in this world family that we're all involved in. These guys were steeped in idolatry, in polytheism, and the true God reached his hand down and plucked them out of that situation and said, "Hey, I've got a better life for you." But they wanted to know, who is it? Who can I trust? Who am I supposed to be praying to bring this great deliverance that you are promising? And make no mistake about it, when God identified himself, he did it in a historical kind of way. What he's saying there is, you know what? Here's why you can trust me to do what I'm promising you to do. Because Abraham trusted me and I never let him down. And Isaac trusted me and I never let him down. Jacob trusted me and I never let him down. In other words, I've got a really good track record of making promises and keeping them. Hang on to me and you will receive what I have promised to you. If I promise deliverance, you better believe I've got a track record of faithfulness and you can trust me. I am trustworthy. I have demonstrated my trustworthiness to you or to your forefathers. Just look back through the generations and see what my track record is. Take a look in my file and see what it says. Next slide. Next passage is, Before God ever gives, here are my expectations. Have no other gods before me. Don't make any graven image. Keep the Sabbath, etc. Before he gives his rules of the road, he announces good news. He tells them who they are. Or who he is. He says, here's where you stand and here's who I am. I am a God who delivered you. You are a people who stand before me as free men, women, and children. Now that we've gotten all that out of the way, let me give you the rules for the road so that free people stay free. People who have been delivered by me can stay in right relationship with me for as long as you will obey me. So before he ever gets to rules of the road, he's declaring good news. Guess what? This God who's going to lay down the law now, I'm a good God. I'm a delivering God. I'm a God who keeps his promises. I am a God who has the power to bring a people out of slavery, servitude to one of the greatest empires that ever existed in the ancient world. And I'm going to just pluck you right up out of there like it's nothing. Just a small move of my pinky finger, and now you stand before me as hundreds and thousands of free men, women, and children. And so again, I'm referring, before we go forward into this any deeper, I want to remind you who I am. He's the God of history. I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of Egypt, out of a place of slaves, literally, the Hebrew says, out of a position of slaves. So this business of Christianity or biblical faith is a historically based religion. Whenever God's getting ready to take them somewhere, he reminds them of where they've been. Is that not historically based? Okay, next slide. Take a look at another Old Testament text. When Joshua, the leader after Moses, bows off the scene, Joshua's about to bow off the scene, and what does he do? Same thing that Moses did in the book of Deuteronomy. He gathers the people together in Joshua 24, and he renews the covenant, this agreement between Israel and God. And what does Joshua say? Before he calls them to a point of, hey, time to step up to the plate and recommit. Time for you guys to get serious with God again and say, yes, this is still for me, and this is going to be for me going forward, and it's going to be for my kids and my kids' kids. This is what Joshua says. From ancient times, your fathers lived beyond the river. And then I took your father Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. I sent Moses and Aaron. I brought your fathers out of Egypt and through the Red Sea. And you lived in the wilderness for a long time. Then I brought you into a land and I gave it into your hand. I wasn't listening to Balaam that was supposed to curse you. And so he had to bless you. And so then I drove out two kings before you, et cetera, et cetera. What is he doing? He's giving God's resume. Here's what I've done before. Here are the jobs I've had before. Look at how well I've performed. Now, I'm calling you to recommit. On the basis of what? Pie in the sky by and by? No, on the basis of what I've done already. Not what I'm going to do, but commit to me because of what I've done, what I have done. I am the God of history. I'm a God whose resume is open for everybody to read. All y'all, if you need some kind of evidence that I am to be trusted, that I'm a God who's got some gravity to him, that you can rely on me in difficult times, just look back. Remember that movie Back to the Future? Just look back. That will direct your future. I am the God of history. Next slide. Other instances of retelling redemptive history. The reason I threw that up there on the screen, and this is not all of them, this is some of the major ones, you'll see that in that 1 Samuel passage, Samuel the prophet did the same thing that Moses and Joshua did. They called the people to covenant renewal, but before he called on them to make the commitment, he said, look at what God has done in our times past. In the history of this nation, in the history of his dealing with people. In the book of Nehemiah, same thing, recounting redemptive history. In the book of Psalms, you got psalm after psalm after psalm that tells the story of God's redemptive acts in the history of the nation of Israel. This is not unique to the Old Testament. You get in Acts chapter 7, Stephen doing the same thing, telling the great stories of how God had intervened and moved redemptive history along, and now we've come to the point where he has shown to us himself in the flesh. Brings us right up to the incarnation event, Jesus in the flesh. Same thing in chapter 13, but this time it's Paul doing this. So there's people all over the place, both testaments, retelling the great acts of God for this purpose, to emphasize how faithful he is. He is a God of history. He doesn't just come from nowhere and say, hey, place your trust in me. Well, why should I? I don't know. Nothing else to do, you know? Or, look, you just got a hope against hope. There's this story that's told about Elvis Presley that he was being interviewed by a journalist, and the journalist says to the king, it was a female, she said, I noticed that you've got an Islamic crescent. You've got Star of David. You've got a Protestant cross and you've got a Roman Catholic crucifix on. What's the point of all that? And the king said, oh, I don't want to miss heaven on a technicality, you know, kind of thing. He's trying to cover all his bases, right? No, this is not a gamble, guys. This is not some kind of a big jump ball. The Bible is describing God over and over as having promised and fulfilled, promised and fulfilled, promised and fulfilled, and that he is a God of history whose track record can be checked. This is all public domain. It's free for everybody to take a look at and then make the decision, can I really trust this God, or is it still some kind of an open question? For God, he's saying, I am trustworthy. I have earned your trust the old-fashioned way, right? I've rolled up my sleeves and gotten my fingernails dirty and greasy by delivering you, providing for you, guiding you, protecting you, over and over and over in recorded human history. Another slide, please. We have this kind of emphasis in the New Testament. When Paul says, here are the most important things in all of your Christian belief system. He says, I make known to you the gospel that I preached, and I delivered unto you as of, and the Greek reads first, or protos, primary, foundational, central, the most important thing holding the building up of protos importance, what I received, and that is that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that in accordance with the Scriptures, he arose again. All of those, from Paul's perspective, he's looking backward on historical events. The most important thing to Paul, all of these are important, by the way, it's not that Jesus is coming back, it's not that the Trinity, it's not some of these other doctrines that we rightly view as being important. He says these are the three most important things that your faith is based on, and all three of them are historical acts. They're events that already happened and have been witnessed to, because right after this, he says, and he appeared to these people, and then he appeared to these people, and then he appeared to 500 people at one time. What is he doing now? He's presenting the evidence that this actually happened. I'm not sure if that's the next slide or not. Let's just check it. Okay, so maybe not. But that's where you go in chapter 15 after these first few verses. He starts presenting his evidence. Yeah, you don't have to take my word for it. And then he says, and many of these have not fallen asleep. In other words, they're still alive. You can go check it with them. Eyewitness reports. This is the way that Paul says, this is the foundation of our faith. So Paul is saying the same thing that Moses was saying, or that God was saying to Moses in Exodus 3. The faith that you have is an historically based faith. It's not based on speculation. It's not based on philosophy. It is based on the historic acts of God in history, the realities of the thing. Is that pretty cool? Is that different than a lot of other faith expressions? Absolutely it is. Christianity is also a content-based faith. There is, the reason that I threw that in there is because there are so many empty-headed Christians today. There are so many Christians whose focus are, it's how it makes me feel. This is a feel-good faith. Well, yeah, it is, most of the time. But it is not without content. This is a content-heavy faith. There's guts to this thing. There's reality and stuff that make it up. Let's just take a look at a few things. Next slide. In Acts chapter 1, verse 3, it says, he presented himself alive after his resurrection with many convincing proofs. There's some guts to that. We could go a multiple set of directions right now. One could be, well, how does that square with the writer of Hebrews? It's the evidence of things not seen. It's the evidence of things hoped for. And I would respond, there are three different types of aspects to faith. There's the past aspect of faith, there's the present aspect of faith, and there's a futuristic aspect of faith as well. We haven't received everything that we have been promised. For example, I haven't received my resurrection body yet. Have any of you guys? Still waiting on that. Yeah, still waiting on the UPS delivery on that. That's coming, but thank God this is not all there is, right? So there's past, present, and futuristic aspects of faith, and when the writer of Hebrews is talking, he's only talking about the futuristic part. So that's the evidence of things not seen. It can't be. It hasn't happened yet, okay? But our faith has more aspects to it than that. For example, Paul says that a most important aspect of our faith, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, all of that are, these are all past tense events. And he goes to this extent. He says, and if these things aren't in place and they weren't really real, then we are of all men to be most pitied, that we are still dead and in our sins, and that we are misrepresenting God. And I would argue that what he's saying is rhetorical, and he doesn't think any of those three things. We're not of all men to be most pitied. We're the most blessed people on the earth, and we're not dead and in our sins, and we're not misrepresenting God. These are rhetorical statements that Paul is making. He's saying these things are real. Feel free to go back and read it yourself, 1 Corinthians 15. But we're going to move on. Acts chapter 1, now all of the sermons and the speeches in the book of Acts focus backward on the life and ministry and death, burial, resurrection of Jesus. That's what the apostles focused on. Every time they opened their mouth, it didn't matter whether it was in a Gentile context or a Jewish context. It didn't make any difference whether the language was Greek that they were speaking or Hebrew that they were speaking. It didn't make any difference whether it was in Israel or outside of Israel that they were speaking. It mattered not that they were speaking to common people or to kings, literally to kings. The message was always the same. They were constantly focusing backward. Their message, what they had to share that was good news, is this is who Jesus is and this is what he accomplished. That should be ours too. I know that there's this popular way of witnessing to people. Hey, do you know that God loves you and he has a wonderful plan for your life? I got good news for you, or I got bad news for you. Almost all religions believe that. That's not an effective witness for Jesus. God loves you and he's got a wonderful plan for your life. Did you know that Jesus loved you so much he died for you? And he put the period on the end of the sentence by rising from the dead. Proved that he was the Son of God, Paul says in the book of Romans, that he was declared Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead. Okay, so it's got to be good news, ladies and gentlemen, is about Jesus. Amen. Good news is about Jesus. Good news is, listen to this. I don't mean to step on toes. You can just kind of retract them a little bit in your shoe. It's not about asking people to come to church. Okay, that's outreach, no doubt about it. And that's getting them exposed to the message. It's not the same thing as introducing people to Jesus. Okay, personal witness kind of stuff. It is important for them to fellowship with the body of Christ and get exposed to godly living and to good preaching. That is important. But these two are not exact. This is stage one, and there's another stage. The person has got to be introduced to Jesus. Where's new life coming from? Where's new life coming from? It's coming from a relationship with a resurrected, Wave Nunnally, no. With the cleaned up New Hope Assemblies of God Church, no. New life comes, abundant life comes, forgiveness of sin comes through Jesus. He's the focus. And so these guys are putting on a clinic in the book of Acts. They cannot open their mouths without talking about what Jesus said and what Jesus did, especially what he accomplished in his last week, death, burial, resurrection from the dead, and ascension into heaven. That's what the early apostolic community is dialed in on. Dialed in on. They can't open their mouths without talking about Jesus and about what he did and what he and the life that he lived, what he accomplished in his death, burial, resurrection. All right, next slide. And that you get, again, that 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4. The thing that is of primary importance in our faith, death, burial, resurrection. Next slide. And then that the fact that these are eyewitnessed realities. This is not something that is philosophically or speculatively based. This is something that is eyewitnessed. That's what's important in Judaism. It's not what you think. It's what can you prove. You've seen that on whole lots of TV shows that are about lawyers and courts and stuff like that. Not what you but what you know or what you think, it's what you can prove. And there you have reference to eyewitnesses. Here's the next thing. Christianity is theocentric, meaning it focuses on God. It is not anthropocentric or focusing on man. I have another piece of bad news for you, but it ends up being good in the end. So hear me out. This is not about you. This whole thing, kingdom of God, right? Good news, gospel, is not about you. It's about God. It's about Him. It's about honoring, glorifying, magnifying Him. As His kingdom grows, so also does His reputation in the earth. Christianity is God-centered, and it's not man-centered. The Bible is a theocentric book. The focus of the Bible is not on you. The focus of the Bible is on God. The focus of the Gospels is not on all the people that Jesus touched and healed or delivered from the power of the enemy or discipled or taught. Rather, the focus of the Gospels is on Jesus. These are books about Jesus, not about fallen humanity. You know why? Because the answer to our problem is not in fallen humanity. That is the siren song of the secularists, the secular humanists, and most of the state institutions today. We can fix our own problems. You know what? All we need to do is throw more money at that. All we need to do is do more education on that. Well, guess what? We've been decades and decades and decades throwing money at problems, and the problems are greater. We've been decades and decades educating ourselves out of problems, and the problems are greater, right? So the answer is not in fallen humanity. Bad news and good news. Bad news is, yes, we had the ability to break this thing, and we did it really well. It's a very, very broken world. It's filled with very, very broken people. So we had the right, the ability to break this. But it's kind of like the little kid. You break your Tonka toy, and they did that. You know, they ran something heavy over it, or they put it behind the car or whatever, but they can't put it back together. They don't have the power to reform those parts and fix the pieces that are broken. So we had the ability to break this, and we did it, and we did a real good job of it, but we don't have the ability to fix it. So you can forget about these utopian ideas that various politicians and on both sides of the aisle have, that all we got to do is raise taxes and spend more money and do more education. It hasn't helped at all yet. It's only gotten worse. All of our social ills, they've just gotten worse. There is an answer, though. But the answer comes from outside of humanity. And that's where we get in trouble with the rest of society, because they're not willing to humble themselves and recognize, you know what? We can't fix this, and I don't have the answer. I'm just as sorry as I can be that there are still children that are born with handicaps. I'm still sorry that there are racial tensions. I'm still sorry that there's gang violence. I'm still sorry that there's teenage pregnancy, blah, 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 on and on and on. But they can't fix it. I don't care how much money in education they throw at it. It's destined to get worse, because the answer does not reside in fallen humanity. The answer falls in the Creator that started this in a state of perfection to begin with. Only He can return it to that state. Okay, so the Bible is Jesus-focused. The Bible is theocentric, God-focused. The Bible is not focused on us, because if we will simply get our eyes on Him, look at Him as the answer, the solution to these issues, then we start getting fixed. But we got to keep the horse in front of the cart. The answer is not us. The answer is not society. The answer is not more enlightened government or better education. The answer is a return to God. So there's the good news and the bad news. He also is the focus of the book of Acts. We talked about the sermons and speeches in Acts and all these different contexts. It's never about, you know what, we have so many problems, or we are such an enlightened people. The emphasis of the sermons and speeches in Acts are not on people. It's not on the apostles. The focus is always on Jesus. And by the way, often these are in the middles of some of the greatest revivals that the world has ever known and the craziest off-the-hook miracles that have ever happened, right? And they step aside and they say, let me just tell you, it's not about me. It's Jesus that raised this man up who never walked, who never saw. It's Jesus that raised this child from the dead. It's not about me, you know. If it was about me, they'd still be laying on the slab dead. This is about God. They're always, constantly, and I think that that's the success of the early church. It wasn't personality driven. It wasn't a cult of personality. The only cult of personality they had was the Jesus that was reigning at that time on the throne. It's all about him. And that's really, that's what he's trying to do with us as well. The constant focus needs to be back on Jesus of Nazareth. It needs to be on the God of the Bible. Okay, so that goes all the way through the book of Acts. It goes all the way through the epistles, the formal letters, official letters that are in the church, and all the way through the book of Revelation. The focus is not 666, who's the Antichrist, what's going on with the Pope or whatever. The focus is on Jesus. He is the bright and morning star of the book of Revelation. The focus is on Jesus. From the beginning to the end, the focus is God. The focus is Jesus. Keep going. Okay, Christianity is based on good news. Good news. We've talked a little bit about this, so I'm going to short shrift this part. You have to listen carefully because I'm going to talk in code. I'm going to talk in shorthand because we've already dealt with this. The answer in Christianity is not to us being better people. You know, I've heard this prayer in church. God, let the people who leave this auditorium be better than the people who were before. Okay, I mean, but is that all that this is about? Is this a self-improvement movement? Huh? Is this CrossFit? Come on. Is this Oprah's radical makeover? If that's all it is, I'm checking out. I didn't sign on for that. And that's not what happened to me either. When God got a hold of me, he started changing things from the inside out. And I mean, he got right down to the toenails and started ripping stuff out of me and putting stuff into me that wasn't there to start with. We are talking not about radical makeover. We're talking about radical transformation, about becoming anyone who's found in Christ as a new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things are becoming new. So we're going to look at a couple of passages that really contradict this idea that I shared with you before. I used to work with a guy who constantly preached this. Look, I know you're saved by God's grace, but look, after that, it's all up to you. That's bad news. Good news is the same Jesus who saved you is going to call you to stuff. And he's going to pull things out of you and put things into you. He's the one who's doing the changing. Our responsibility is primarily, in reality, passive. We have to yield. We have to allow. We have to submit. We have to humble ourselves. We have to make ourselves available. And that's all the entree that God needs. I'm not diminishing the responsibility that we have to go to work every day and feed our children and make sure that we, you know, aren't running stop signs and stuff. What I'm talking about is God wants us to make ourselves available so that he does the heavy lifting, the real internal changing that changes our motivations, that changes our attitudes, that changes our perspective, that changes our outlook on life, that changes our priority system and how we make decisions and what's important and what's less important. God is renewing our mind. I'm just going to suggest to you, you can't do that. You go see if you can yourself renew your own mind. All of a sudden, you are into some kind of Scientology, some kind of L. Ron Hubbard sort of weirdness. But the God that called us is also the God who's going to change us according to Scripture. His Spirit is going to work on the inside as we give him opportunity. There are things that have to change in all of us that we simply can't accomplish ourselves. The best we can do is give God opportunity. Yield to him. Humble ourselves before him and say, God, if this is going to change, it's got to be you. I'm making myself available. I'm going to stay on my face before you. I'm going to give you all the face time you need. I'm going to give you all the opportunity you need. But I know that you're the one who's going to have to do the heavy lifting. Okay? Another major difference between Christianity and other world religions is this idea of indwelling. You know, almost everybody, every faith expression says, oh, God bless you, God be with you, God go with you, God be near you, and that kind of thing. But in the New Testament, we're promised that God will take up his dwelling on the inside of us. So that, listen, ladies and gentlemen, we become two-legged, breathing, walking, moving, living, portable arks of the covenant or tabernacle that was built in the wilderness, that was carried around on the shoulders of priests and then set up again everywhere the Israelites stopped. And that's where people went to meet with God, okay? We are that. Paul will say this. Take a look at the first slide. Your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. That means God's living inside you, right? Take a look at another passage. You are being built together, this body of Christ that you're a part of. You're being built together, each of you being a stone, a different stone, into a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. So not just you individually, but you collectively as well. God doesn't just live with us and among us, but he lives in us. He's taken up his residence inside of us. Did you know that everywhere you go, church, school, park, Walmart, Hy-Vee, bowling league, whatever, did you know that whether there's been prayer before or whether that's the most ungodly place in the world or the most godly place in the world, that when you show up, God is already there because you brought him with you? I've always had this struggle. Maybe I listen too carefully. Maybe I'm too exacting. Okay, so what? Whatever. Let's all rise and let's pray and let's invite God's presence into our midst. And I'm going, really? Because you're the guest. This is his house, right? Has that ever kind of struck you as? And another thing is, when the first person got to church that day, that was in right relationship with God, especially someone who's full of God's Spirit, they come walking in the door and flip the first light on or turn the heating unit on or whatever, fire up the projection mechanism or whatever, God is already in that place. Why? Because that person, if it's a janitor that makes $20,000, if it's some CEO that comes strolling in here that's a six-figure guy, it makes no difference. If God's living on the inside, God is present in that place already. By virtue of stuff like this, don't you know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? I didn't make this up. This is not me that just trying to convince you of some kind of a reality by the force of my own personality. Okay, this is the Word of God. What you believe that says this, it's telling you, you are a portable tabernacle of the living God. You are the Ark of the Covenant of the living God. And wherever you go, he goes. You guys are yoked together. Good, bad, and different, you guys are, he's there. He is there. Next slide. Christianity promises that God will radically transform the nature of those who submit. And we've talked about this just a little bit, but the point is this. It's not just, hey, he's going to help you look a little bit better to your neighbors. He's going to fix you up so that your wife doesn't leave you. That's peanuts to him. That's nothing to him. What he wants is radical transformation. Old things have passed away and all things become new. So let's take a couple of looks at passages that focus on this. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed. The word there is metamorpheo. You know what we get from this in English, right? Metamorpheo. Metamorphosis, exactly. One is a verb, the other is a noun. That's all. The meaning is the same. It means radical transformation so that what went before looks practically nothing like what comes after. And the classic example, as I mentioned maybe Sunday morning in church, is we study this and we apply this kind of language to the various life stages of a butterfly. It starts off with an egg, and then in the next stage, it's a larva. But if you looked at the two and you didn't know that the two were intrinsically connected, you would go, no, this has nothing to do with that. It looks entirely different. And then from the larva to the caterpillar, right? You would say, there's no connection, but you actually saw the metamorphosis, the transformation, the radical change with your own eyes. And so you go, okay, well, yeah, this is related to that. It just looks nothing like the stage that went before. And then the greatest change, maybe most impressive change, is when that ugly, creepy, crawly, you know, you hate to have them on your finger, caterpillar changes into that glorious, gorgeous, beautiful, flapping butterfly, right? That's metamorpheo. That's the verb. And look, I want you to look at, is this passive or is it active? Be transformed. Think back to your old elementary school, high school, whatever days we're learning English. Remember the active voice and the passive voice? Help me out with this. Is this the active voice? Be transformed. Active is when you are generating the action. That would have to read if it was the active voice. Don't be conformed to this world, but transform yourself. You would be generating the action. So if it's not the active, it must be the what? Passive. So how do we define passive? You are being acted on. Someone from without, somebody outside of you is acting on you. Be transformed means, you know, let go and let God. Let your hair down, take a deep breath, leave mastery of your own life behind, and give God a chance. Open up, yield, submit, humble yourself. Make yourself available to Him. And the one who works from outside of us, be transformed. That means that we are the object of God's tinkering. Let Him tinker with y'all. Let Him tinker with me. Let's let Him tinker with us and fix us. Remember when Pinocchio got all broke up and Geppetto had to kind of put him? He didn't fix himself. The action has to come from without. Be transformed. Let yourself get transformed by this power that comes from without. Next passage. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. This is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Memorize this one. Put this on your refrigerator in one of those little 3x5 cards with a magnet. Okay, we can all afford that. Get this deep down in your heart. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things passed away. Behold, all things become new. It's not just a radical makeover Jesus is looking for in your life. That's good news. And also the good news is, and what he's looking, this radical change he's looking to inject into you, is not by you just going to church more. Or being more regular in your daily devotions. Or instead of reading the Bible 10 minutes a day, reading it 15 minutes a day. Sorry, it just doesn't work. This is not about base touching. This is about giving God an opportunity in your life. Giving Him free rein to work you over real good, regularly. You know, kind of like a health club where you actually do go after you've paid the dues. This is like letting God have His way with you on a regular enough basis to really make a new you out of you. That's His desire. Honesty, humility, straightforward, not playing around in prayer, not trying to impress Him with being able to do it in the King's English, but letting Him have His way inside. Next passage. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I live, but it's Christ living in me. I want to know, is that what we can we sign off on that and say, yeah, that's a present reality in my life. That's so obvious that anybody who knows me, my spouse, my next door neighbor, the guy who works beside me at work or whatever, yeah, he would say exactly that about me. Then that means we're a candidate for more work, a little bit more overhaul. Just a little bit more, not just body work, but engine work, right down to the core of who we are. It's Christ living in me. Next passage, Ephesians chapter 4. You know, in reference to your former way of life, lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new self, which is in the likeness of God, that has been created in righteousness, holiness, and truth. In other words, the very things that mark God's character, righteousness, holiness, and truth, those things become more and more indicative of or descriptive of you as you continue to, on this continuum, this process of transformation, becoming more and more and more like Him and less like the old, could I say, larva or caterpillar or egg, right? Those earlier versions of us that we're not real crazy about anymore. Let that process continue. I urge you, I challenge you. It won't end until we die. You know that, or Jesus comes back. That process has to go on. You're not going to arrive. Stay in process. Stay in process. Just like committing to being a lifelong learner, commit to stay in this process. Yeah, I know, Dr. Nunnally, but that hurts. It's painful being in that process. I know, it's like John Mellencamp. Doesn't it hurt so good? And it just hurts so good. Or the Nike thing, no pain, no gain, right? Stay in that process. You know you love it. Next passage. Another is another uniqueness of Christianity. We have the corner on this market, is that God empowers us. We don't just live this life He's called us to live in our own strength. The other world religions are, if you analyze them carefully, they all have this in common. They are all just base touching. They have rules, regulations, expectations, requirements. They have the bar set at a certain place. And if you're going to be an adherent of that religion, well, these standards, these expectations, these responsibilities, they just kind of come with membership, right? You got to pay your dues if you want to sing the blues. And you know it just ain't easy. Ringo Starr. Yeah. Not so with Christianity. We have made it like that, but that's not the real deal. That's not the biblical faith. Hey, we've made it if you just come to church often enough, if you just pray often enough, if you read the Bible often enough, do your devotions often enough, go to revival often enough, witness often enough, whatever. And for so many Christians, and this is why they're not living abundant life, by the way, and this is why they're weary, okay, and maybe why they're sometimes frustrated and why they often show out in the flesh, you know, as stuff bubbles up to the top, is because they have become comfortable with their religion or their relationship with God being a, yep, I did that, yep, did that, got that done, yep, but remember I did that on Wednesday, yes, that one, yeah, I missed that one, but that's okay, he wasn't looking anyway, he was busy over the ball game, and got that one, and we have become a kingdom of base touchers. It's just, I'm just touching bases, just checking off my boxes on my checkoff list. But that's not what God has called us to. God called us, He said, I will, whatever I call you to, I will empower you to. As simple as that. Faithful is He who calls, and He will provide. He will do it. That's what we get in 1 Thessalonians 5:24. The God who calls, He says, I want you to stay here in the city. For what reason? Until you are endued with power from on high, and then you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Acts 1:8. This God that calls us doesn't think quite as highly of us as we think of ourselves. It's like, okay, I got that call. I answered the call. Yes, now I'm a Christian. All right, all you got to do is give me my marching orders now, and I'm good to go. All I need, point me in a direction and I am going there. I'll throw all my human effort. I'll throw all my good looks. I'll throw my soprano voice, my perfect pitch, all of my ingenuity and creativity and hard work ethic, and I will get that thing done. And God says, no, you won't either. because I'm going to raise the bar high enough where you cannot get over it in your own strength, by the power of your own flesh. Make no mistake about it, God is not interested in us sharing his glory. He'll share it with no other, just won't. Amen. And so when we make the draw the line at the bottom of the ledger page and we go, yeah, I got all that done. Does that glorify God? I made that happen. I got that vacation Bible school. I ran that thing on my own. That was my idea. That was my creative. That was my hardware. I was up there all hours of the night getting all that stuff ready for all those kids. I made that happen. Does that give glory to God? The answer is, survey says, no, it doesn't. So what is it that God wants to do? He wants to set the bar so high, you look at it and you go, not a chance, God. I'm running to you. I'm coming running to your arms to help. Help get me over that bar. Empower me. Strengthen me. Quicken my natural creativity and take it up to the next level so that when everybody sees it, they'll go, yep, God did that. He got that done. Can you believe that God used that? Have you ever read the book of Judges? Go back and read it. It's the Cartoon Network of the Old Testament. Go back and watch, look at the crazy people that God chooses to work through. And then what happens? God's people are delivered. And they live in safety, they live in security, they live in the blessings of God. And it's because some weird guy said, well, okay, God, if you're going to pick me, I'm the least of my clan, and my clan's the least in the tribes, and my tribe is the least of the people of Israel. Okay, God, if you want to use me, okay, I'm a candidate. And all of a sudden, God does this great thing. And who gets the glory? It's God who gets the glory. He's still doing that today. We could be the cartoon characters in the Cartoon Network of the Old Testament. We could be the people, the stars of the book, in a sense, of the book of Judges, because all of us are like that. We've all sinned and come short of the assemblies of God, or something like that. Okay? So God still rolls that way. He hasn't changed. He's still, Paul says it in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Let's just fast forward about 1,200 years from the book of Judges to the first century church. And Paul says, consider your calling, brethren. Not many of you were wise or of noble birth or rich, but God has chosen the foolish things and the weak things of the world to confound the wisdom of the wise and the strength of the strong. For what reason? He tells you right there in that same passage, so that no flesh might boast in his glory and his presence. But let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. So that's the reason that he's picking people like us. Poor, broken, sinful, out of fellowship with God, in wrong relationship, broken relationships all around us and in our wake, in our background. And God picks us. And what he wants to do is he wants to do extraordinary things through us. Not average, not mundane, not regular, not just what you can do by your own reach. He is constantly going to be calling you guys, calling me, to stuff that we go, not a chance. Not a chance in this world. Seventh grade, true story. Seventh grade, all of us had to give a quote, short presentation. What that translates into is a blown up speech for me. I got up there. I had my dumb little cue cards. I got nervous. The kids are muttering. Now they're snickering. And I get even more nervous and I drop the cards. Dumb me, I don't number the cards. So when I pick them up, they're all out of order. So then what I say after that makes no sense at all because it's all out of order. And they're, by this time, they're just howling and laughing. I wait until everybody leaves the class. And I stay intentionally until I'm the last student in there. And I walked up to the teacher. I said, ma'am, I was one of those that gave presentation today. Yes, I know. She's still reeling in horror, right? And so I say, I just want you to know you can send me to the principal. You can spank me. That's when they used to do that back in school. You can put me in detention hall or you can suspend me. I just want to put you on notice that I will never, ever again stand in front of a group of people and speak publicly.
God.
Famous last words, don't ever say ever, never, right? God is going to put us in those situations. They're incubation situations. It's kind of boot camp kind of thing. How are you going to respond to this? The response has to always be on our part. We've got to train ourselves to think like this, to run to God. Anytime you get a call from Him, it's practically always going to be just out of your reach. You know, most religions are like that too. There's a carrot in front of the donkey where you can never quite attain. Most religions are like that. Christianity has the carrot out there, but God says, guess what? I'm just going to take that by my power, and I'm going to make that accessible. I'm going to make that put that within your reach, not because of your strength or because of your wisdom, not because you're so well-healed or your education. I'm going to do this by my power that works mightily within you. That's the way He works. Now, okay, are you uncomfortable with that? Fine, you're in great company. Me too. Because of all things, I am self-reliant and self-sufficient. That's our fallen human nature. It's all about me. But see, again, it's not all about me. The good news is supposed to be we've been set free from the gospel of all about me, which is a crash and burn religion. It's all about Him. Okay? Do we have others? Is there more? Yeah, there's always more. It is God who is at work in you, both to will, in other words, to want to be able to do it, and to work, and to be able to do it for His good pleasure. So He changes our attitude. Okay, what I didn't want to do, now I do. And He empowers us to work for His good pleasure. It's God who is at work in us. It's not our coolness. It's not just our level of preparation or level of dedication or level of commitment or whatever. It is the work of God in us. Next passage. I can do all things, and that's what we usually focus on. Hey, you know what I learned in church? I can do anything. That's fallen human nature. That's anthropocentric. That's man-centered. That's us on the throne. That's not the focus of Philippians 4:13. I know most of you know this by heart. Please recalibrate the focus of this passage. It isn't on us. It's on God. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. The answer's not in me. It's through His provision of strength, empowerment, that charis that we talked about the other day. The word that's translated grace is most often in the Bible not about God's mercy. Most often not about, you know, your ability on the balance beam. That grace, or about, you know, social graces and manners. Most of the time in the Bible, when that word charis, grace, shows up, it's about His enabling power. His power, His divine power that He pours, loves to pour into human vessels. And then Ephesians. This is one of the best ones in the whole Bible. Paul says he was made a minister according to the gift of God's charis, that enabling power. It's not about God being a mannerly God, saying yes sir, no sir, having the knife in the right place on the table. It's the gift of God's enabling power, which was given to me according to the working of His power. He spells it out there. It's very clear now what he means with respect to charis or grace. Who is able to do, and this is so weird because we've taken this as a passage about prayer. Yeah, let's pray because we know that God is able to do abundantly above and beyond all we can ask or think. That's true. That's a great, you know, extension, maybe a secondary application of the principle in this passage, but that's not primarily what Paul's talking about. Here he's talking about he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. According to His power that works within us. It's about enabling us to do what we can't do in our own strength. That's mostly what this is, primarily what this is about. It's not a passage about prayer. It's about God's divine enablement to make us capable of doing stuff we can't do in our own strength. And I let you decide which is cooler, but I'm just telling you that's where Paul's going with this. Now, you feel free to take that passage down and you go back and you study it in context and you get out your Bible helps and stuff like that, and you decide whether that's right or wrong. I'm just saying the primary purpose of this passage is to talk about God who enables us to do stuff He's called us to do that we can't do in our own strength. It doesn't have to do primarily with being able to pray things that God can do more than we can think of to pray. You see what I'm saying? There's a difference. If you, if after your careful study, you agree with my interpretation and application of this passage, then we're all good to go. And if not, then you won't have me back. Or whatever, you know. Just take that one and discard it. Next passage. For this purpose, that is to present everyone complete in Christ. I'm looking at the bigger context. I labor, striving, and look at the language that he's using. I'm laboring and I'm striving. So it's not that we don't apply ourselves, but it's the key is according to his power that works mightily within me. That's the key. Oh, look, man, everybody, even unbelievers, are out there in that world and they're laboring and they're striving. They're working 80-hour work weeks. They're staying up late working on the books, right? Everybody's trying to make ends meet and working hard. I come from a world of workaholics. My wife does too. Okay, so it's all right to give it a little elbow grease, but if that's all there is, then that we're going to come up short in the work of God, what he calls us to. Why? Because he wants to add his power to. We make ourselves available. We put ourselves into the moment, but God has to do the empowering, or we live lives of frustration and we never get to that abundant life that Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Next passage. The reason why we are going through these uniquenesses, differences between Christianity and the rest of the world religions is because we know what kind of world we live in, right? And so one of the things that we want to do, we want to be challenged, we want to be stirred up in our most holy faith, but we also want to be equipped to be able to make a ready defense to everyone who asks us to give an account for the hope of, why are you a Christian? Why have you chosen this out of that whole marketplace of world religions? Why are you, have you heard this before about you or anybody else? Why are you different? Why are you so different? Be ready to give an account for that hope that is within you. And this is some of the stuff that we've equipped you with tonight, the uniquenesses of Christianity. You want to sit down and talk about it over lunch? Very good. I have many things to share with you. Some neat stuff that I'm praying that God will root down deep inside of you and will give you a springboard to share with other people and to ground you more perfectly, more completely, more fully in your most precious faith. So now what I'm wondering is if, and we're out of time and we're basically done.